Hello, I'm Wendy. Today I'm painting a watercolour landscape. I'm corning it across the lake and it's a narrated demonstration painting. The lake is in fact a reservoir. It's called Clinbrian. It's a reservoir close to where I live in Carmarthenshire and it's a favourite place of ours to visit. It was late summer when I took these photographs and I was really drawn to the pinks of the rose bay willow herb. They look really stunning against the greens of the trees and the blues of the lake, and I'm going to do a little painting. You can get totally overwhelmed if you're a landscape painter by the beautiful landscape that's around you. You just want to paint everything, but that's not possible. What I think is the best thing to do is just pick out an area that really appeals to you and have a go at painting that. Don't take on anything too much. And I decided on taking this little bit here with the flowers in the foreground, the lake going off into the distance. I hope you enjoy the video and I hope you find something useful in it that will help you in your own paintings, whether you paint in a loose style or a more detailed style. If you would like to share the work that you do, and then any work that's related to my channel, then do post in my Facebook group and there is a link in the description box. I was working on a Saunders Waterford block, 140-pound knot surface for this painting, and the image size was about 8 by 8 inches. It's a very rough drawing because I do like to draw with the brush and sort out the composition to a certain extent and what I'm going to do as I'm painting. I don't have any real preconceptions about what it's going to look like in the end, but I did think it was important to put the hills and make sure that they were in the right place and also indicate where the prominent trees were because those shapes were important to the composition. I started out by masking out some of the flowers on the rose bay willow herbs here. I do tend to use masking fluid quite a lot. I find if you're painting in a loose way and you want to put all those trees and everything in the background and you want to do them quite quickly, then it is advantageous to have the flowers masked out. I did them fairly big, the flowers here. I could have done them a little bit smaller, but I think they worked in the end, the size that they were. If you're painting something along these lines, you might want to be a little bit more realistic with the rose bay willow herb. It's entirely up to you. It depends on your style. I tend to do things quite broadly and quite loosely. But as I said, everybody is different and would tackle these in a different way. With landscape painting, you generally start from the back and work forwards when you're working in watercolour. And you generally start with your lightest colours, which is what I'm doing here. So I'm starting off with the sky and I'm using very, very dilute cobalt blue with some Payne's grey to make a sort of grey-blue sky. I didn't want it to be too blue. It's quite a pretty painting and I didn't want it to be overly pretty. And so this sky, I think, works quite well. I brought it down a little bit over the hills and softened the edges because I don't like to have hard lines separating areas. So you'll see quite often when I'm painting that I do soften edges and I don't leave hard lines on there. I put a bit of extra paint in the top to add a bit more interest, a few of the greyer clouds. So that was a stronger mix of those two colours. And then I deliberately kept the lake very, very light. It was very light in the photograph and I really did like that effect. I think if I'd made it dark, you wouldn't have got the contrast I was looking for with the trees in the foreground and the flowers against the lake. Again, I'm using the same colours as the sky here. Possibly you could put a touch more blue in it. And I'm working wet into wet, trying to just vary it a little bit with a few darker colours in there. There was a suggestion of some sort of mauvey distant colours in the photograph, which I thought would work well. So I put some of those in before putting on the green. Again, you can see that I do keep softening edges as I'm working. I know people can have an awful lot of trouble mixing greens, particularly when they're starting out in watercolour. I think the main thing is not to be too bothered about getting exactly what green is in front of you, because you're never going to do that. I was looking at this photograph and I was seeing them as warm greens, very pale. When I say warm, it was this raw sienna seemed to work quite well. You don't want them to be lots of yellows and things in them to bring them really forward, but you can keep your greens warm in the distance by using the raw sienna, and I'm using the raw sienna with ultramarine, and I thought that worked quite well. It sort of got this sort of warm summery feeling of the hills. And for the darker, more shadowy areas, I just added some more ultramarine to the mix. I was trying to keep the distant hills very simple, not to overwork them. I wanted them to recede into the distance, and I think if you put too many layers on and overwork the hills, then that's not going to happen. So I'm trying to do each hill in one layer, putting on a lighter colour and then dropping the other colours wet into wet. You can, as the first layers dry, you can add a darker, thicker colour to put the shadow areas in. So you're doing it all in one layer, wet into wet. And personally, I think that works really well in enhancing the recession, or the feeling of recession in the picture. Doing a bit of dotting about with a darker colour is hopefully giving the impression that you've got some trees there on the side of the hills. You can see that as the paint is drying, some of the darker paint is staying more in place. And as I'm building up these washes, this even darker colour going in now, that will dry back. Now these hills on the right hand side were certainly in shadow, and so I used more of the ultramarine with the mix. We've got the raw sienna with the ultramarine there, and that is looking quite cooler. Even though it's nearer to you than the distant hills, it's still working because it is cooler and it's all going on in one layer again. I'm not making it a lot more detailed at all. I do work quite a lot from photographs, and I don't copy them exactly. What I like to do is to pick out the things in there that really appeal to me and not necessarily reproduce them exactly, which is basically what I'm doing in this painting here. I like to have something in front of me to work from. I like to take inspiration from nature, from the colours and the tones. I think especially when you're starting painting, you always want to get things looking right, you know, put your strokes down so that they mirror what's in front of you, which really, unless you paint really realistically, really is a mistake, because you're never going to be able to do that. You want to put your strokes and your colours down in a more impressionistic way, I think, and not worry too much about getting things so-called right all the time. Now for these trees in the foreground, I did, as you can probably see, I did change the greens and added more of a brighter yellow in there. You can brighten them up because they're in the foreground, you want them to be warmer and more yellow in them. What I find when I'm mixing these greens as well, I think I'm pretty certain I've stuck to ultramarine here. If you find they're getting a little bit dull, and ultramarine can make the greens a little bit dull, then I like to add a bit of sap green. Sap green is a lovely colour, it's a good mixer, it's nice on its own in light areas, but it will, if you put it in with your mixers, it will liven them up and brighten them up a little bit, I find. This part of the video is speeded up just times two. I do paint fast, but not quite as fast as this. And you can see that I'm just trying to vary the strokes a bit. I've got a few different colours going in there, a few different greens. I'm using a different brush here, just using the tip of the brush to make some marks. This is where using the masking fluid comes in so useful, because it would be quite difficult to paint around the rosebay willow herb. You couldn't paint the rosebay willow herb in watercolour on top of these greens. It just wouldn't work. You've got to keep the transparency of the reds and the pinks in the flowers. You could always use a body colour, like a gouache, for the flowers as well. But again, it's just changing the media, and if you want to stick with pure watercolour for the picture, then I don't really think you've got any option but to put some masking fluid on. I do have a video telling you how to use it with some tips, and I'll link that in the description box if you're unsure about using it. The masking fluid that I use, again, is linked below. It's got this light blue tinge to it, which I don't mind. It means you can see it. I don't like some of the masking fluid that are very bright colours, like bright blue, because it sort of puts me off. I don't know what colours to put next to it. I can't judge my other colours against some of these garish colours of the masking fluid. So we're starting work on these foreground trees, and as a tip, I know these trees are going to be dark over the lighter background, but sometimes you sort of see the background, in this case the background hills, sort of still showing through the trunks, and that doesn't do an awful lot for this feeling of recession. To get this feeling of recession, these trees in the front have really got to look as if they're in front of the hills. And what I find is if I use a damp brush, and really damp, so I rinse out the brush in water and take just about all the water out of it, then you can pull out some of the colour and spread it along the trunk. And I find this is going to be really useful, especially on this right hand side here, because those hills there are dark. And I would even out the tone on the tree by pulling some of that green through and getting rid of those hard edges. It looks a bit messy now, but you're going to be going over it with a dark brown. And a few of the little trees here as well. Again, I'm speeding this next little bit of the painting up because it is quite repetitive. I'm painting the trunks and the twigs, and I'm using ultramarine and burnt sienna. That should do the job, I think. The trunks and the twigs were very dark brown in the photograph, and I think that works quite well. Particularly if you're a beginner, beware of this mix, because quite often you can put too much of the ultramarine in the mix and it makes the trunks and the twigs far too dark. It makes them a sort of bluey black, which is not terribly attractive, so try and keep them on the brown side. Now you'll find that I'm having a bit of trouble painting these because I couldn't move the pad around because I've got a camera above, and if I'd moved the pad around, I wouldn't have got it back into position. So I'm finding it quite difficult painting these the way that I'm doing it now. So that's why it's looking a bit odd sometimes. I'm not quite sure where to put the next stroke. Some of these trees were broken down, and this one in particular here now had snapped off, and I found these shapes really interesting. And it was part of the character of the reservoir was having these sort of broken down trees and tree stumps and things, and I thought it was really quite interesting and nice to put them in. Using a rigger brush with this dark mix to put the twigs on, and again I had quite a bit of a problem here deciding where to put the brush strokes, because it really was tricky not moving the pad around. I hope you see that the painting really starts to come together, doesn't it, once you start putting the once you start working on the trees and putting the twigs in. Going back and having another look at the photograph here, there were some trees on the left-hand side there, and I'm suggesting those with this tree here. I used, again, to remind you and to remind myself, I used ultramarine with raw sienna, but this time I added a warmer yellow, something like a cadmium yellow in there as well, and livened it up a little bit with some sap green. And a few of the darkest darks going in here. At this stage, there wasn't an awful lot more to do on the trees. I didn't want to overdo it. I'm keeping an eye on the photograph all the time. I added some of the thinner trees on the left. It's always a good idea, I think, to, well, it is showing you in the reference as well, to have the trees actually going out of the picture. So I did some of those. As I said, keeping an eye on the photograph, put a few more twigs and a few more little branches on the trees. I dotted around a few leaves. I think sometimes, even though you've not got any leaves maybe on your reference or from your sketches when you're doing a painting, it's a good idea to suggest a few leaf shapes on there. Otherwise your trees can look dead. They can just not look very attractive, and just a few little dots of paints here and there gives them a little bit of life. So I was just about finishing the work on the trees here, and I like to put a few sort of random strokes around. It's just the way I paint. I think it adds a bit of interest and a bit of life into the foreground. And we've got some extra little bit of the trunks going in as well. So a little bit of finishing off. Then what we're going to do is pop a mount around it and see what it looks like. So I'd rubbed the masking fluid off at this stage, and it is looking better, I think, with that taken off. It's left those lovely white shapes there, which are all ready for putting the pink on for the rose bay willow herbs. The pink, I would, if you're doing pink flowers, just pick one of the pinks in your palettes, adjust it a little bit, maybe with a bit of blue in places to suggest some shadow. But I would certainly put it on very thinly and very transparently, because that's the way watercolour works the best, rather than putting lots of layers on. Again, I think I'm working mainly wet into wet here, putting a lighter pink and then dropping in some darker tones of it. I used rose madder and maybe a bit of crimson alizarin, and as I said, in places with just a touch of the ultramarine there, just to change the tones. You could leave a little bit of white too. And I did leave a few of these, I don't know what, seed heads or something, that I popped in with a bit of raw sienna. I used a very dark green to pick out some of the flower shapes and maybe tidy them up just a little bit. I didn't want to overwork it. I wanted the foreground to sort of be in a similar style to the very loose background. Well, I do hope that you enjoyed watching me paint that. I enjoyed painting it, and I hope that you picked up some information that would be useful when you're painting your own pictures. Clearly, you're going to have to adapt the techniques to your own style, but I think the techniques that I was talking about, the watercolour techniques, will stand you in good stead in your painting. Bye for now. I look forward to doing my next video, which will be up in a week or two, and it will be another landscape. Do subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so already. It is free, and you will be notified when my next video comes along.